a sign of transition at the White House today, moving vans.
Inauguration Day, of course, means moving day over at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. They're going to begin unpacking the White House
today. The presidential transition ends on Wednesday with Bill Clinton moving into the
White House. Will be ready over the next 2 hours to receive it.
The historic moment of the inauguration is fast approaching.
Presidency, it's the Obama family today moving into a new house.
It's the most famous address in America. 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
We're going to switch live to the White House, where one of the unique aspects of American tradition is taking place.
But the residents only have a four-year lease.
Transitions in the White House are just a matter of course, are a matter of life. It's a function of our democracy.
I think walking in the White House the first day and realizing, okay, here we go. If you're not humbled by that, then you're probably not, you're not thinking straight.
I was at the White House for seven transitions. They are enormously complicated.
Can I speak to Jim, please?
And our intent at the end of that period of time is to have no boxes, no wrapping paper, and have everything unpacked and put in a place so that when the first family walk back into the White House, that it is their home.
After the inauguration, we got back to a totally furnished, unpacked house. It was amazing.
I know I actually had a moment to take in the fact that I was now living in the White House with my two young daughters and the President of the United States, who happened to be my husband. That's when it hits you. The sense of history and responsibility just wafts over you.
This is not like any other home. It's a workplace and a showplace. It is here that the president charts the country's course. It is here that history is made every single day. This is the White House.
I went into the White House with a feeling of challenge and excitement because of the overwhelming history. Thomas Jefferson lived there. Lincoln met in a small room that became one of my favorites. And I would study at night in what Harry Truman has used as his office. So I was filled with admiration for the history of my country and the history of the White House.
Ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
We are a united people, pledged to maintaining a political system which guarantees individual liberty.
Whatever America hopes to bring to pass in the world must first come to pass in the heart of America.
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
My fellow Americans, our long national nightmare is over.
An idea infused with the conviction that America's heroic journey must go forever upward.
The American dream endures. We must once again have full faith in our country.
I will lead, and I will do the best I can.
Of unity, diversity, and generosity, shared and written together. Thank you, and God bless the United States of America.
One of the really great things about our country is the peaceful transfer of power. It's a wonderful symbol for the rest of the world. There is a great continuity in the White House.
To usher in that transfer, new presidents take part in a ritual procession down Pennsylvania Avenue to their official residence. It was the first president, George Washington, who undertook the construction of an executive mansion in a brand new capital city.
Its location was important to him. It was more or less the center of the country.
George Washington didn't want the Capitol to be in the East, New York or Philadelphia. So he approved the building, this new city, and he set about getting it designed himself.
President Washington laid the cornerstone for the house in October of 1792. And even today, the building reflects his vision. Many of the men hired to build it were Scottish immigrants and free African-American citizens.
Every kind of race, creed, and color was involved in the building of that house because laborers were hard to get and it was not high paid.
But much of the really backbreaking work was done by people who weren't paid at all.
The fact of the matter is that slave labor was absolutely instrumental to the construction of the house. Not only firing bricks, but laying foundations, indeed raising the original walls.
From the quarries, when they get stones, to bring it to Washington, putting them together, bricks and mortar. It is indeed enslaved labor and free African-American labor involved in bringing this White House into existence.
The building would take 17 years to complete. Washington himself would never have the chance to live here. It was an imposing structure. At the time, the largest residence in the country. But it was nearly burned to the ground during the War of 1812, when the British invaded the capital. In the middle of the night, enemy troops threw flaming javelins through the windows.
And then bang, and that set the attic on fire, which was wood with the joists and rafters and things, huge timbers. And then as that happened, it burned through the floor to the main floor, the blue room and all those rooms. And then the main floor burned and crashed into the basement. The White House was just like a big box containing burnt ashes.
British soldiers destroyed or looted nearly everything in the White House. But before she fled, the First Lady took time to rescue a precious work of art.
Dolly Madison said, "President Washington has to be saved." And they had to crack the frame open in order to take the canvas out on its stretcher. And it went off in a wagon to safety in the countryside and was restored to the White House after the rebuilding. So it's continuously hung in the house since the house opened in November 1800. And ever since, Dolly Madison has been given, you know, the credit for being the great heroine of the War of 1812.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 43rd President of the United States, George W. Bush and Mrs. Laura Bush.
I am pleased that my portrait brings an interesting symmetry to the White House collection. It now starts and ends with a George W. When the British burned the White House in 1814, Dolly Madison famously saved this portrait of the first George W. Now, Michelle, if anything happens, there's your man.
When they come back for the final set, they're coming through Palm.
Correct. Ground floor and the public staircase.
Okay, terrific.
It is an intricate structure. Made up of countless moving parts.
Because of, obviously, the bilateral relationship, there are major delays.
All somehow perfectly in sync.
Guys, we're moving in direction.
And at the center of all that frenzied activity, the heart of the American body politic, is the Oval Office in the West Wing. Here, presidential power really comes into focus.
There is an aura to that office, an aura of power that presidents are very well aware of. The Oval Office gives the President of the United States the greatest home court advantage that's ever existed.
This is where presidents mark many of the nation's pivotal moments.
I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made from the White House.
Which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan.
This is where they announce crucial decisions.
Shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack.
Where they sign landmark bills and greet their most important guests. For the first 100 years of White House history, there was no Oval Office and no West Wing. Presidents worked wherever they could find a convenient space. Some on the main floor, others upstairs near their family's private quarters. By 1900, President McKinley and his staff of 23 men were crammed into makeshift offices at the east end of the second floor, spaces originally intended as bedrooms and family rooms. The next year, Teddy Roosevelt took office, invading the family residence with his 6 rambunctious children. The house was bursting at the seams. Clearly, something had to give.
The family felt scrunched under Teddy Roosevelt's time. There were like 30 rooms in the White House, but there were only like 5 bedrooms for the family, and they had all these kids. So the decision was made to create the West Wing as an office space.
Greenhouses were demolished on the west side of the house to make way for Roosevelt's new extension. On November 5th, 1902, the president finally had a dedicated place to work. As the chief executive's staff continued to grow, the West Wing was doubled in size, and a new office, an Oval Office, was built for President William Howard Taft. The running joke was that they arrived at the shape by laying the rotund president down on the south lawn and drawing a circle around him. Over the years, the Oval Office became the embodiment of executive power.
I used to sit in the Oval Office sometimes early in the morning, and I would deliberately look at a globe that was there. And I would turn it to Moscow. And I would try to put myself in the position of President Brezhnev and how he looked at his own country and how he looked at my country. And I would try to think how I could avoid a potential war between the two superpowers.
Nobody wielded power more effectively in the Oval Office than LBJ. And LBJ used that advantage. He knew about the trappings of power. And he knew that if you brought somebody into the Oval Office, that they would get a sense of that right away. And that would give them this tremendous advantage in any negotiation or any conversation that he might have.
You're being invited in and seduced, and you're getting some good information, and you're also getting some spin. It's the Oval Office. You know you're there.
Well, during the course of my administration, when I met with the leaders of the Soviet Union, with the leader of China, with multiple leaders from African countries, Latin American countries, it was very helpful to have them approach the Oval Office with some degree of awe and intrepidation because of the aura that naturally surrounded the Oval Office as a center of American executive leadership.
Here in the Oval Office, presidents steer the nation's course from behind the historic Resolute desk. It was a gift from Queen Victoria to President Rutherford B. Hayes in 1880. Crafted from timbers salvaged from a British naval vessel, HMS Resolute.
At this desk, wars have been launched, peace has been hammered out, conflicts averted. You know, major legislation that helped millions of people, in some cases generations of people, have been forged. And so you appreciate the weight of it.
The desk was moved to various locations in the White House by a number of presidents. But it wasn't until 1961, when Jackie Kennedy discovered it stashed away in a storage room, that the Resolute desk finally made its way into the Oval Office. This room may be familiar to the public, but for the president, it's also a private refuge, a place to think and reflect, and to keep up a personal connection with Americans who are always eager to share their concerns.
Dear President Barack Obama, my name is Robert, and my partner Chet and I live in Colorado. Chet and I had a hell of a time this past year, but Friday, June 26, 2015, turned our sad year into a very happy day. We watched the news that the Supreme Court had defeated the ban on marriage for gays. I cried as I listened to the Washington Gay Men's Court. Dear President and Mrs. Obama, I want to tell you a little bit about my family. My husband and I can barely afford the basics. I'm pretty sure this is a silly thing to do, to write a letter to the president, but I'm writing to let you know what it's like for us out here in the middle of the country, and I hope you will listen.
Every day, the White House receives thousands of letters, email messages, and faxes addressed to the president. 10 of them are selected by his aides and included in his evening briefing book.
These 10 letters that I get every day, I think, serve a similar purpose, which is to make sure that in all the hustle and bustle that's taken place here, we don't lose sight of why we're here. Dear Mr. President, I've been living the past few years with some health problems that are extremely expensive. My insurance has completely changed my life for the better. I want you to know I owe you a favor. I know it's very unlikely, but all you need to do is ask.
Each president is trying to figure out his own way as to how to keep that link with the public alive. And letters, I think, are one of the means, because people just will write in to their president as if they're writing to a friend sometimes.
Dear sir, will you excuse my daring to address you and enclosing this petition for my eldest son? Don't, dear Mr. Lincoln, refuse to listen to a widowed mother's prayer.
Dear Mr. President, I am 6 years old. When I was little, I had infantile paralysis. My right arm is in a brace. My left foot is better since my operation. I like to see your pictures. I like to hear stories about you. Jimmy Stone.
It was the idea that you can feel that you can actually write to the White House and the president will respond.
It is a way for me to stay in touch. I've said before that occupying this chair is the great privilege of my life, and probably the greatest privilege that any citizen can have, to serve the entire country for a short span of time.
Between managing affairs of state and responding to the people's concerns, the president may have the most demanding job in the country, but you can't beat the commute. From the West Wing, it's a short trip down the hall and upstairs to the place they call home, the official residence. Here they can escape the spotlight and try to live a normal life.
My parents actually brought some of their furniture from Alexandria to the White House. My dad wanted his easy chair that he had had forever. He wanted it at the White House. There used to be a president's bedroom and a first lady's bedroom. Well, my mother said, you know, we've slept together for 20 some odd years and we're gonna continue. So they took the president's bedroom and made it into their private den with their furniture that they were comfortable with. They said, if we're going to do this, we're going to do it so that we're comfortable and it feels like us.
After a few weeks, it becomes home. And you'd be going along and not thinking every day about here I am and what am I doing. Then you look down and here's Abraham Lincoln's place. And you get this incredible feeling. It gives me chills now even when I think about it.
The upstairs at the White House, which isn't seen by everybody, is filled with history. You feel a lot of history, and you hope you can live up to it.
Every room has 100 stories. This is where Jackson was. This is where Lincoln was. This is where Teddy Roosevelt stood. This is where the kids played.
Abraham Lincoln was able to have regular office hours where people would come and wait outside his office, which was over in the residence, and without an appointment, if they waited long enough, they might get in to see him. And they could, you know, seek his help on everything from trying to get a job to asking for a pardon for their child.
Every time you walk in the hall upstairs in the residence, you think about the people who lived there before you. And what is now the upstairs dining room, that's where Mary Todd Lincoln brought Willie, their child, when he got sick. And then that's where he died, in that room. And I think about it often, because after September 11th, we thought often of the challenges that other presidents and their families faced while they lived there.
Behind the scenes, keeping everything running in good times and bad, is the household staff. A bevy of cooks and ushers, housekeepers and butlers, gardeners and groundskeepers.
Yeah, first thing I'd like to do is just roll, if you could roll out the red carpet so I can see that it's...
And one person is responsible for keeping it all in sync, the chief usher.
I have a team of 100 employees. Our schedule is primarily driven and directed by the schedule of the president and the first lady.
Angela Reed is only the 9th chief usher. And she's the first woman to hold the job since it was established more than 120 years ago.
Will you take the green room?
Absolutely.
And then we'll be ready for the guests to walk up the steps and come in for the receiving line.
As head of the household staff, she is in charge of day-to-day operations.
All right, so let's take a walk down to the flower shop.
Making sure that the first family's personal and public lives run smoothly.
We're in the heart of the house. This is an area rarely seen by regular visitors to the house. And this is where the employees, you know, our ladies and gentlemen, really get the work done. So this is the heartbeat of the house, so to speak.
Yeah.
It's lunchtime.
The resident staff at the White House is just so key to the first family having a good experience of living over the store. Whether that means making your favorite birthday cake or having a special dinner in the family dining room.
So press comes in, they preset at 5:30. There are days when we have a jam-packed schedule, when things are changing on the fly. They're in North Portico, but when they come back for the final set, they're coming through Palm. We work in a very fluid environment.
Okay, terrific.
I don't think there are any 2 days that are alike. I haven't had those 2 days yet since I've been on board.
The photo line is over.
I see Vaughn and George over there, so I guess they're responsible for tonight,
absolutely.
Right? Every day is different because of what goes on in the country and the world. So one day could be a state visit, the next day could be a kids' luncheon, or it could be a press conference, it could be a bill signing. It could be just simply, personal activities that the family will engage in.
In an era of scorched earth partisanship, when many people at the White House invariably become associated with one party or the other, it's hard to appreciate just how non-political, how discreet, and how intimate the relationship between the permanent staff and the impermanent residents.
The resident staff is well respected by first families for their incredible tight-lipped behavior.
as far as, you know, seeing and knowing and never sharing. We serve every family equally, regardless of the politics. The presidency and the White House is what we are defending vigorously.
These are people who, you know, I don't worry about what I look like early in the morning. You know, I don't necessarily worry about whether my teeth are brushed or, you know, it's like you can really completely let your hair down with this group of people who are here to take care of you. They make you feel like you can trust them unconditionally.
When I interviewed people for jobs at the White House when they came open, and it wasn't very often, but when it did occur, one of the first things I asked them was not about the job, was I asked them if they could protect the President and First Lady's privacy. That was a primary consideration before I even talked about whether they could cut a piece of wood as a carpenter or serve a dinner at the table.
One's there.
One there. And
a big part of the staff's job is to keep the President and his family on an even keel. After all, even the President of the United States has good days and bad days.
We'll see them looking a little bit down and concerned due to situations in the national or the world order here. But for us, as resident staff there, we're just there to make them as comfortable as possible and make that time as easy going for them. And so when they come home for dinner at night, if it'd be 7 or 8 o'clock at night, they're just very happy to be sitting down and have a nice hot plate of food.
I'm gonna have to go.
I want to get your little wood in anyway. I bet you think you're going.
I don't.
Sometimes as I walk around the house, I do pause and reflect on the historical events that may have taken place in that particular place where I'm standing or walking through at that moment in time. So it continues to be surreal.
Since the earliest days of the presidency, the residential staff has mainly been made up of African Americans. But they didn't always serve by choice.
The presidents at this time are mostly required to take care of the expenses of the White House on their own dime. So when you're a slaveholder, you're going to bring in your staff.
For seven presidents, that meant bringing their slaves to the White House.
Our creed was that all men were created equal, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Of course, the author of those words in our Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson, was the third president of the United States, and he was a slaveholder. George Washington was a slaveholder. So there is this liberty dichotomy in this country.
That dichotomy finally began to end when Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1st, 1863, in his White House study.
Running like a great fault line through 200 years of history is the issue of race. And that house is sanctified because Abraham Lincoln lived in that house and waged the great moral battle to preserve and redefine the Union. And it joins all the other historic events that add up, not only to the history of that house, but in a great many ways to the history of the country that it reflects at its best.
Over time, the household staff became really a place where African Americans could find good jobs in Washington. A lot of these jobs were passed along from one generation to another in families, and they were very valued in the African American community. Working in the White House was very important. And I know that when President Obama was elected as the first African American president, a number of those household staffers turned down really better jobs and retirement so they could work for him, because for so many years they never thought they'd see an African-American president, and they just wanted to work with an African-American president, at least for a while, as sort of a dream of theirs that came true.
Members of the White House staff have a unique window on history. They watch it unfold within these walls. births and deaths, wars and celebrations. For a few of them, that privileged view has spanned decades. Chief Butler Alonzo Fields served four presidents over the course of 21 years. There was one moment in particular Fields would never forget. On December 7th, 1941. He was walking past Franklin Roosevelt's study soon after news came of the attack on Pearl Harbor, when he saw the president hunched over his desk, his head in his hands. Fields paused at the doorway where he heard the president say, "My God, how did it happen? I will go down in disgrace." A few weeks later, the staff learned that an important visitor would be arriving soon. His identity was kept top secret until a car rolled up at the White House door on December 22nd.
The one time I would love to have been there, just in the corner, is this winter that Winston Churchill came and spent Christmas with Franklin Roosevelt.
The whole rhythm of the White House was undone by Churchill's visits.
And he had roaming rights in the White House. You know, he had his own bedroom upstairs, and he would parade around buck naked at some point.
And he told the butler, Alonzo Fields, that he had a few requirements. He needed a tumbler of sherry every morning before breakfast. He needed two scotch and sodas before lunch. And he needed 90-year-old brandy and French champagne before he went to sleep at night. And he didn't want any whistling in the corridor.
Can you imagine a foreign leader moving into the White House and joining forces with the President of the United States? I mean, think about the dimensions of that and the historic importance of that. That must have been something to be witness to.
For the staff, dealing with the unexpected is just part of the job. Even when the White House is gripped by tragedy, they must rise to the occasion. On November 22, 1963, when John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Texas, the staff had the sad duty of preparing for his funeral. On the flight back from Dallas, the First Lady asked her staff to find out how Lincoln was buried.
Mrs. Kennedy's secretary, Mary Gallagher, called and said, "Mrs. Kennedy wants the funeral as much like the Lincoln funeral as possible."
Staffers found the old plans in the National Archives. And in a vault in the basement of the Capitol, they discovered a rectangular platform made of rough pine boards, believed to be the catafalque on which Lincoln's coffin had rested while he lay in state.
It was 20 minutes after 4 Saturday morning when his body finally arrived at the White House. And I wondered what I would say when Mrs. Kennedy got to the elevator. And as she came around the corner, our eyes met, and I knew I didn't have to say a word. It was difficult. It still is so vivid in my memory. Her coming around the corner, and still with the pink blood-stained suit on. It was rough to take, and something you'll never forget.
A military honor guard carried the casket to the East Room, where the body of Abraham Lincoln had lain nearly 100 years earlier. The ties between the military and the White House run deep. After all, The president is not just the political leader of the country. He's also the commander-in-chief. Today, Sergeant Kyle White and his family are visiting the White House, where he'll receive the nation's highest military award, the Medal of Honor. Sergeant White proved his courage in Afghanistan when his unit was ambushed. Braving enemy fire and ignoring his own injuries, he tended to his wounded comrades. By tradition, the Medal of Honor is awarded personally by the Commander-in-Chief here at the White House. Ask any president, and they'll tell you there is no burden that weighs heavier on their shoulders than sending young men and women into harm's way, and no privilege greater than honoring their courage.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, accompanied by Medal of Honor recipient, Sergeant Kyle White.
It has been said that true courage is a perfect sensibility of the measure of danger and a mental willingness to incur it. The men and women of our armed forces have known the measure of danger that comes with military service. But they have displayed a selfless willingness to incur it by volunteering to keep us all safe.
The White House has always been the setting for ceremonies, both solemn and festive. For every president, special occasions are celebrated as a welcome break from the day-to-day routine. Back when John and Abigail Adams lived here, they brightened their still unfinished home with a reception and formal dinner. For entertainment, there was an ensemble of military musicians, Marines. And the Marine Band has performed at White House functions ever since, which is why they're called the President's Own. Over time, the White House has become a kind of epicenter for entertaining. And an invitation to party here is a coveted prize, even for the biggest stars. It's a chance for the elite of Hollywood and Washington to rub elbows with world leaders.
President Ufu A. Boigny, his wife, arrive at the White House for a state dinner given in their honor by President and Mrs. Kennedy.
State dinner while the number can change. They can start at 150 and end up at 260. Location can change, so that means you plan something. Let's say you plan a dessert which is going to have ice cream or sherbet or thing. Now, the worst situation happened once to me when you have a dinner in the middle of the winter And the dessert is a hot souffle. And they come and see me after having that souffle in the oven for maybe 30 minutes or so and said, "We miss a guest. And we can't serve until she's there. This is Mrs. Barbara Bush. She's stuck somewhere at the airport or something with the flight." You know, souffle don't wait. When it's the time, it's got to go. When you got to go, you got to go. You know the story. So the souffle is the same way. But actually, those souffle came out absolutely perfect. Could not have done better.
Of course, the White House is more than a culinary destination. It is also a place to celebrate the American culture. Every president and first lady have staged performances at the House that reflect their own taste and the times they live in. During the Civil War, Lincoln had the Marine Band play a lot of patriotic music, like the popular battle cry of freedom, and they held weekly concerts on the lawn. President Hayes's taste ran more toward opera, and one of his musical evenings in 1878 featured soprano Marie Salika, the first African-American singer to entertain at the White House. John F. Kennedy and First Lady Jackie Kennedy opened the house to the nation's finest artists with performances of opera, ballet, Shakespeare, and legendary musicians like Pablo Casals. In 1993, when President Clinton celebrated the 40th anniversary of the Newport Jazz Festival at the White House, he joined an all-star lineup of musicians for a sax solo. In the East Room, the White House staff preps for an evening performance, the same room where First Lady Abigail Adams hung her clothes out to dry.
I hope everybody's in the spirit tonight. Church. White House.
AM, the West Wing. White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest starts his day.
Good morning.
Hey, Josh.
Knowing that you are 40 or 50 feet down the hall from the Oval Office and the President of the United States is a pretty awesome feeling. What's happening? Both in terms of how neat it is, but also in terms of the amount of responsibility that's associated with it, that it connotes. And I don't think that's something I've ever gotten used to.
Part of Josh Earnest's responsibility is to inform and manage the White House press corps. A gaggle of reporters from assorted print, radio, TV, and digital outlets. They gather every day here in the briefing room to learn whatever they can about the president's day-to-day activities and major policy decisions.
You are there when the president is making big announcements, meeting with world leaders. You're just a few feet away and down the hall from where momentous decisions are being made.
The idea that in the middle of the world's greatest country and the greatest democracy in the history, there's a central place, and you get to go there every day and see what the President of the United States is planning to do about the big issues before you. What more would you want as a reporter?
There wasn't a day when I covered the White House where I wasn't amazed that I was walking into that building every day.
Afghanistan is still a dangerous place, and sure enough,
you never lose the sense that you're in the middle of it all. I call it sitting on the front row of history.
$175 billion in new tax benefits. How would he spend that money? He would give money to the middle class.
It's easier to describe the creation of the universe than to describe the relationships between the press and the White House.
That complex relationship is nothing new. The press has always had an intense interest in what the president is doing and what he's thinking. But reporters haven't always been so welcome in the White House. In the 1800s, many presidents preferred to keep the press at arm's length. That finally began to change around the turn of the 20th century. Legend has it that one day, President Theodore Roosevelt spotted a group of reporters standing in the rain outside the White House, and he invited them in. Reporters had worked in the White House before, but it was Roosevelt who gave them their own room in the West Wing. In the 1930s, another President Roosevelt, Franklin, enlarged the press office. FDR enjoyed chatting with the press and often invited them into the Oval Office. Sometimes, though, he asked them to keep his comments off the record, and they complied.
The press room was in the West Wing, in a corner office. And there were guys with hats sitting in the lobby, smoking cigarettes. And the press room had a large rectangular table in it with manual typewriters on it and phone booths on two walls. And people were always moving quickly in all directions. And there was always a crisis to be settled.
They had big old stuffed chairs. And you mixed and mingled with people who came in for White House appointments to see some staff member of the president's staff or even the president himself. The press secretary's office was right off of the reception area of the West Wing. Small office. Access to the president was frequent, and there was a lot of it.
Motion picture cameras joined newspaper reporters for a historic presidential press conference.
With the advent of television, the press had new tools to cover the White House, and the president had no choice but to cooperate. In 1955, Dwight Eisenhower agreed to hold the first televised news conference.
Well, I see we're trying a new experiment this morning. I hope it doesn't prove to be a disturbing influence.
Television provided presidents a powerful way to reach the public, but it demanded new skills.
A conversation with the President of the United States. Last evening in his office, Mr. Kennedy looked back at the first 2 years.
John F. Kennedy understood the political value of TV, and he knew how to use it to get his message across and cultivate his image. He even invited reporters into the Oval Office for an informal primetime interview.
I would say that the problems are more difficult than I imagined them to be. The responsibilities placed on the United States are greater than I imagined them to be.
I think in some ways, John F. Kennedy changed things for the press. He made press events these wonderful spectacles. They were prime time events. The American people looked forward to a John F. Kennedy press event in the same way that we look forward to Game of Thrones. You know, there were these wonderful happenings.
Kennedy's successor took press relations to a whole new level.
President Johnson had decided early on that he wanted to give maximum access.
Johnson had absolutely no boundary between work and private life.
In his office, have an ongoing question and answer conversation with him up close and personal. And Lyndon Johnson also gave the press access to the living quarters of the White House.
If he wanted to continue a conversation and he's walking down the corridor and he goes, wants to go into his bedroom, come and take a nap, you come in and you sit down on the bed and you talk to him, which is not a normal way that private public behavior is boundaried. But part of that was that he was the most colorful human being that any of us who knew him have ever known.
It was not unusual for President Johnson to to say to his press secretary, get that SOB in here, I want to shank his ass right away. And you'd be hauled into the president. The president would get nose to nose at you and say, what the hell are you doing to me, boy?
I mean, when he was in high spirits in the White House would reverberate with high spirits. When he was in a grumpy mood or sad or angry, it pervaded the White House.
If Kennedy and Johnson were famous for their casual, even chummy relations with the press, the next administration took quite a different approach. In 1970, President Nixon moved reporters out of the West Wing and away from his office into a new briefing room in an adjacent gallery. And just under this room lies a forgotten piece of White House history.
Now we're going downstairs into the swimming pool. The swimming pool is right underneath us. The briefing room was built over top of the swimming pool. And just want to show you some of the nice things that have gone on down there.
For Franklin Roosevelt, stricken by polio, a daily swim was therapeutic. The president had the White House laundry room converted into an indoor swimming pool. Its location in the West Gallery, between the residence and the West Wing, gave Roosevelt and his successors a convenient place to escape and relax. President Truman used it regularly and was known to swim laps with his glasses on. First Lady Jackie Kennedy found the pool room drab and uninviting. Murals were commissioned to add a touch of the tropics. Her husband, JFK, had grown up on the water, and he loved to swim, often in the buff. Lyndon Johnson was inclined to call a break right in the middle of important meetings and order everyone to join him in the pool for a mandatory swim.
Watch your step. Welcome to the swimming pool underneath the briefing room. We have miles and miles of fiber optic cable, and this is how all the TV stations, radio stations, what have you, get all their information out, and they also get information into the White House. All the guts of the TV stations, radio stations, is kept right here. Most people who have come into the briefing room have come down here into the swimming pool to sign the wall. And we have, thousands upon thousands of signatures down here. If you look around, you'll see all these signatures all over the walls and even on the floor.
As for the pool itself, it's now only a memory.
The briefing room was built over top of the swimming pool when Nixon got tired of the press pool being in the lobby of the West Wing. So what happened is he said, you know what, we're not using that pool, we'll cover it over, and we'll put them in that area and they can stay away from me.
Hello, George, on that thing we were discussing this morning, I wanted to be sure that you got off of...
Nixon White House staff made it clear right from the beginning that they viewed the press as hostile and dangerous to the political health of the president.
That's enough.
The press is the enemy. They didn't want the press on the White House grounds, in the White House itself, even in West Wing. It was, get these so-and-sos out of my sight, out of my hair. We're not going to have them hanging out in the West Wing of the White House, that's for damn sure. So we were, in effect, in a corral. Couldn't move out of it without strict permission. And permission was extremely hard to come by.
Even now, decades after Nixon, the press remains penned in its corral.
We are part of the woodwork here, part of the furnishings, but we don't have the run of the place. We are confined to the White House press room and the press secretary's office area. To go anywhere else, we need to have an escort. So we're free to move around here and to move on and off the grounds, but not elsewhere on the grounds.
How is it to cover the White House? It is the most exciting beat in the world. You are on the front line of history. On the other hand,
you don't have great access. You're behind the door.
Today, with the 24/7 news cycle, presidents, first ladies, the family, they come into our homes more than ever. The White House is figuratively, if not literally, ringed with satellite dishes, everyone primed to communicate the latest utterance to come from the House.
Good news, Andrea. The president didn't have trouble with his free throws this time, as he's done in years past.
There could be, in the immortal words of Mae West, too much of a good thing.
I remember Mike McCurry, Clinton's press secretary, telling me that he felt that he was going to have a press secretary for the daytime and the nighttime because the cycle never stopped. Well, now, you know, on that basis, you need a press secretary for every 5 minutes because the news is flowing all the time.
People sometimes like to say, boy, you really got beat up by the White House press corps that day, or boy, there seems to be a lot of tension between the White House and the press corps. And my response to that is, if there weren't a little tension between the White House press corps and the press office, then one of us wouldn't be doing our job.
Let's do it. Good afternoon, everybody.
If you work and live in the White House, the constant glare of the press is simply inescapable. And that's true not only for the President and First Lady, but for their children too.
Dear Sasha and Malia, we were 7 when our beloved grandfather was sworn in as the 41st President of the United States. We watched as the bands marched by, the red, white, and blue streamers welcoming us to a new role, the family members of a president. We also first saw the White House through the innocent, optimistic eyes of children.
For the children, and even the grandchildren of American presidents, the White House is not just a place of pomp and politics. It's a place to play, to learn, to grow up. And unlike most kids, they have to do it all in the public eye.
It's very difficult, I think, to be under that glare. Because you know that anything you do is going to reflect on your parents. And my mother said, don't do anything that you don't want to see on the front pages of the New York Times.
They've come from someplace where they can be out in the open on their own, and now they're in a fishbowl.
Well, this was my home. When we were little, coming to visit your grandparents at the White House is unbelievably magical.
It's an unbelievable house to live in. It's just unbelievable.
What better place to celebrate those special occasions at the heart of childhood memories?
Are you a big guy?
We would come during the holidays. So we would come when it was decked out with trees and smelled unbelievable and all of our cousins were here. And then when my dad was elected president, he continued it.
It's like the best 5-star hotel and the best 5-star service.
Susan Ford and her family are moving out of their house in Alexandria. Susan and her cat, Chan, will live up on the 3rd floor of the White House.
But to have my own bathroom to myself, I was in heaven. To have somebody pick up the clothes that I dropped on the floor, and within hours, they were cleaned and hanging back in your closet. As a teenager, with heaven.
You're gonna be in a bed?
Not in my bed.
I don't think there's one right way to live in this home and create a space. It requires, you know, focus and a solid foundation of knowing who you are, knowing what your passions are.
The residence, which over time really does end up feeling more like home, at least the second and third floors, especially when you got a couple of teenage girls in there who aren't overly impressed with any particular history and are more concerned with the things that teenage girls are concerned about.
For presidential children, indifferent to politics or statesmanship, the executive mansion is their personal playhouse. And they can elevate the mood of the president, even in his darkest hours. That was true for Abraham Lincoln's youngest sons, Willie, who was 11 when his father became president, and Tad, who was just 7.
Those two little kids were rambunctious, spontaneous kids who brought life to the White House. They had a fort on the roof. They would burst into cabinet meetings and Lincoln would welcome them spontaneously. And they brought a certain sense of youth and energy to the sadness of the war because they still were merry little kids.
Surely no group of children created more mayhem in the White House than Teddy Roosevelt's brood of 6.
Theodore Roosevelt and his kids just descended on Washington like a thunderstorm and were colorful and outrageous and wonderful.
The Roosevelt family loved animals, and they had a menagerie of dogs, birds, guinea pigs, snakes, rabbits, badgers, a one-legged rooster, even a small bear named Jonathan Edwards. On one occasion, the kids maneuvered their pony named Algonquin into the White House elevator and brought it up to the second floor residence. But it was 17-year-old Alice who really rattled the White House rafters and shook up her father, the president, too.
Alice notoriously set out to shock public opinion and succeeded, really, for most of her long, colorful life. She used to stand under the main staircase of the White House smoking cigarettes, which was verboten, with a green snake dubbed Emily Spinach wrapped around her neck. She was not above jumping out and telling tour groups that the president beat his children regularly. It was that kind of family. It was a sitcom set to real life.
An exasperated Roosevelt told a friend, "I can either run the country or I can attend to Alice, but I cannot possibly do both."
The White House is such a special space for kids that they have to take over.
Everybody showed up for the prom. I went to the usher's office and they said, as long as you pay the bills, sure, and they let it happen. Every parent wanted to be a chaperone and everybody got a date. I mean, you could get a date for this prom.
Presidential kids are really no different from most other kids. They always manage to make their presence felt.
Margaret, how do you like the Secret Service men following you around on tour?
Well, they follow me on tour, but they don't go with me on my dates.
One of the butlers there is caught her. Amy's roller skating in the East Room. And I said, well, she shouldn't be doing that.
She didn't do it with my permission, but I found out later that she was with her friends.
Once President Clinton said that I can deal with Bosnia, I can deal with Saddam Hussein, but I'm not sure if I'm ready to deal with a teenager.
The amazing thing about the White House is we see families grow and evolve. And that's true for the children in the White House.
You have presidential children that, talking of rites of passage, walking down that grand staircase in their bridal gown, getting married in the White House.
Wilt thou love him, comfort him in sickness and in health?
And in the case of the Johnson White House, we saw Lyndon and Lucy Johnson go from more or less adolescence into young adulthood and then adulthood.
2 days after his return from New York, the president's oldest daughter, Lyndon Burr Johnson, became the bride of Captain Charles Robb of the United States Marine Corps. Historically, it was the first White House wedding in 53 years.
It was exciting being in the White House. But I think we gave up some of the fun things that ordinary teenagers do. Lucy once, she asked for her birthday present, I think it was her 16th birthday. Can I have a day without the Secret Service?
I think it's difficult for the first families to maintain privacy. The press are right outside of the door. First families don't have the freedom to get out and walk around.
One president understood that his children could be an asset, helping him to connect with the public and reveal the lighter side of life in the White House.
Jackie Kennedy's out of the country, and he says to Evelyn, go get the kids and get them down here. And so his secretary brings these kids down to the Oval Office, and they're dancing around, and Kennedy thinks it's a hoot, and the pictures get out, and we all love the pictures. That would never have happened if Jackie Kennedy had been home, because she didn't want her children in the pictures and in the photographs.
As JFK expected, Americans found his kids and the images of these intimate moments irresistible. But the press doesn't always portray presidential children in a sympathetic light, especially when their behavior goes beyond mere mischief.
And tonight, the perils and the promise of being a presidential offspring. Jenna, who's 19 years old, was ticketed for underage beer drinking.
Well, when George told Barbara and Jenna that he was going to run for president, they said, you're going to ruin our lives.
Obviously, we wanted to be normal college kids. We were normal college kids. We went to public school in Austin High, and then all of a sudden, our dad was president.
There's a scrutiny that you get as the son or daughter of a president that anybody who's been a teenager probably can't possibly imagine. And when Jenna Bush started acting up in college, as any college student might, Barbara Bush said famously, George W. is getting a little of his own.
I wouldn't want to be a teenager today if you paid me. In the White House, it's such a different world. That 24-hour news is tough. You don't know what it's like until you've lived there.
Well, the hardest part for any family member, really, is watching their parent or parents characterized in a way that they know they're not. Our girls wrote a letter to Malia and Sasha because they were worried about those girls. They wanted to protect them. They wanted to make sure they knew that they didn't need to worry about their father being criticized.
Watching them get critiqued was hard, and we did. We wrote a letter to Sasha and Malia because that was the one thing I think we learned is that, you know who they are and always remind them who they are.
Sasha and Malia, here is some advice for you from two sisters who have stood where you will stand and who have lived where you will live. Surround yourself with loyal friends. They'll protect and calm you and join in on some of the fun and appreciate the history. Slide down the banister of the solarium, have swimming parties, and play sardines on the White House lawn. Cherish your animals, because sometimes you'll need the quiet comfort only animals can provide.
It is a fabulously magical place to live. But surprisingly, it wasn't that difficult making it a home. Because as I tell my girls, and Barack and I talk about this all the time, home is what you make it. And it's really the spirit that you bring to the place that makes it home.
Over the years, the White House was well used by a succession of first families. But it wasn't always well maintained. By the middle of the 20th century, the White House was, quite literally, falling apart. In 1948, President Truman's daughter Margaret was playing the piano upstairs in the private quarters when, to her horror, the leg of her piano punched through the floor to the family dining room below. Truman had inherited an aging and decrepit White House, more than 150 years of wear and tear and haphazard renovations had left the structure riddled with cracked plaster, rotting floors, and faulty wiring. The engineering report was bleak. The house was too dangerous to live in. One inspector told the president it was staying up from force of habit only. Some suggested tearing down the White House and rebuilding it from scratch.
There were all sorts of reasons, practical reasons, to demolish this old house before it fell down and replace it with a modern, efficient substitute. To his everlasting credit, Harry Truman, who had a great sense of history, said no.
After months of planning, construction work began in late 1949. The project was scheduled to take 2 years and cost $5.5 million. Of course, like all renovations, in the end it would take a lot longer, 3 years instead of two, and it would go way over budget. The interior of the house was completely gutted, down to the studs, but Truman insisted on preserving the building's original exterior walls. He saw them as a crucial link to the past and a symbol of the American spirit of resilience.
They built a steel frame inside the four walls, which were about all that really remained. Interestingly enough, much of the lumber that was taken out of the house, President Truman found ways to preserve it. It was turned into paneling in a number of rooms in the house.
And while they were gutting the house, Truman made his daily inspection. He liked building a lot. And so he went to a door, a basement door, and they were gonna knock it down and make it wide enough for a bulldozer and a dump truck to go through. And he said, no, I won't have it. So they had to take the dump truck and the bulldozer apart and reconstruct them inside, and then dug their basement. He was very resolute in saving the house that George Washington had built.
The President of the United States, at home on Saturday afternoon, May 3rd.
In the spring of 1952, President Truman showed off the refurbished White House on national television.
In the basement, in the cloakroom, we're crossing the hall again, the main corridor here on the ground floor, and into, let's see, this room, Mr. President?
Is the old kitchen.
The old kitchen. It doesn't look much like a kitchen today, sir.
The old kitchen. It has wonderful fireplaces at each end with all the cooking utensils, which we put back in there. Here's the base of the construction of the White House.
When do you think it's going to need it again, Mr. President?
Well, I think in about 1,000 years.
Mr. President, I wasn't interrupting.
The White House may have been structurally sound at last, but another resident would bring her own sense of history and her discriminating eye to the building's furnishings. Jacqueline Kennedy had toured the White House as a child, and she remembered feeling strangely let down by what she saw. she had the same reaction when she moved into the house in 1961. It was decorated in a random mix of periods and styles without any unifying vision or plan. "It looks like it's been furnished by discount stores," she complained. "There is no trace of the past." She wasn't far off. Much of the furniture had been supplied at cost by B. Altman's, a New York department store. The First Lady set out to give the White House a thorough makeover. She formed a fine arts committee to help guide her acquisition of period furnishings from America's past. And she invited collectors to donate their antique treasures. Her goal was to make the White House into a showcase for American design, with rooms purposely arranged to reflect the evolution of the nation's style and taste.
Mrs. Kennedy, I want to thank you for...
On February 14, 1962, Jackie Kennedy, as ever soft-spoken but poised and charming, opened her home to the American public in prime time.
Because I think this house will always grow and should. It just seemed to me such a shame when we came here to find hardly anything of the past in the house.
The ratings were staggering. More than 80 million Americans tuned in, nearly half the country. Jackie wanted to honor and preserve the legacy of the president's home, and she made certain that its collections would be cared for by experts.
Well, the curator of the White House, it was a position that was unofficially created by Mrs. Kennedy. We're a little different than most curatorial offices in that our collection isn't behind ropes, under glass, so that the guests come in and sit on the furniture and walk on the carpets and eat off the china. I think it's that idea that we let them, people go into rooms where the president does his job, and how unusual that is. He was in here last night. It was a dinner. He sat here and talked to the visiting head of state. It's not some ceremonial wing where the king or the queen is living in the other 500 rooms down the block. This is it, and these are the rooms. You know, there's that place that just connotes America.
Even though the presidential spouse is never mentioned in the Constitution, she plays an important role in every administration. For the First Lady and her staff, the East Wing is their headquarters.
Even at 6 a.m. or 3 a.m. or whatever time you get here, you still walk in. The first thing I see when I walk in my office is the side of the house, and it's just, this is a view that nobody really sees ever, and I get to see it every day. So this is the East Wing. We're the sister to the West Wing. This is mainly where the First Lady's staff work. This is the First Lady's press office. It's tiny, I share it. It's a tight fit and we're a tiny team, but we do a lot. a lot. It's a memorial edition of Profiles in Courage, and it's signed by Mrs. Kennedy. I promised that I would keep it on the bookshelf in the White House, and there it sits, under Beau and Champ.
The job of First Lady may be unofficial, and she's not paid for the work she does. But in every administration, she wields a lot of influence.
It's a matter of history, what women have done in the last 100 years.
I think Americans have such a fascination with the role of First Lady. You know, who is this person that is closest to the leader of the free world?
The moment for the announcement.
I mean, essentially, at the end of the day, they are the closest confidant, the most trusted.
My fellow Americans.
And you can't be fired for being in that job, in that role of First Lady. You know, where advisors may be reluctant to sometimes tell the president what he needs to hear, not what he wants to hear. They're the spouse, and that's an entirely different relationship.
Ladies and gentlemen, my husband, President George W. Bush.
Well, there are many parts about what the First Lady does that are traditional, that First Ladies have done since the very beginning, and a lot of it has to do with being the hostess at the White House. Planning the state dinners, hosting the state dinners, reading to the children the Christmas story, the night before Christmas. All of the things that First Ladies have done from generation to generation. But First Ladies have always done a lot more. We just don't really always give the First Ladies that much credit.
They are these hybrids. They walk a multitude of tightropes. They are subject to criticism, much of it unjust, for their clothes or their furnishings or their children.
Betty Ford's comments about premarital sex have stirred up reaction from London to Manila.
There's no doubt they are exploited for political advantage.
What about China? What are you going to take to China to wear?
I haven't figured that out yet. I'm more interested in what I'm going to see when I get there than what I'm going to wear.
Is it fair, or am I being indiscreet?
Well, the role of First Lady is constantly evolving. Every person that is the occupant of that position defines it the way that they want it to be.
First ladies didn't always have that kind of freedom and flexibility. And they didn't always relish their position as mistress of the president's house. Martha Washington wrote to a friend, "I think I am more like a state prisoner than anything else." By the 1930s, one first lady was ready to liberate herself and use her position in a very public way. Eleanor Roosevelt never wanted to be a president's wife, and she resisted the customary duties of the First Lady. Bucking tradition, she spoke out on issues she cared about, from women's rights to civil rights.
If we turn away from the needs of others, we align ourselves with those forces which are bringing about this suffering and which we must eventually try to defeat.
She became the most powerful First Lady probably ever. She changed the ceremonial role of the First Lady in 1,000 ways.
At a time when women were still barred from White House press conferences, Eleanor defied the rules by holding her own, just for female reporters.
It created an entire generation of female journalists because publishers had to hire their first female journalist in order to go to Eleanor's press conferences.
Each First Lady does her own thing to the best of her ability. But if you were talking about Eleanor Roosevelt, she made the rest of us look like pikers.
The role of First Lady can be whatever she wants to make it. I used to be asked if I thought the First Lady ought to be paid. The First Lady is going to be paid, she's going to have a job description. And I wanted to do what I wanted to do.
Rosencarter sat in cabinet meetings, which was very controversial at the time. She was very open in saying that she advised her husband on policy, which she did do.
It was Rosalind Carter who formally established the office of the First Lady inside the East Wing of the White House.
I don't think there will ever be a future First Lady who will just be pour tea and entertain. It's such a wonderful bully pulpit, I call it. It's such a wonderful place to be to pursue any interest that you have.
If I were giving advice to a new spouse or First Lady, what are we going to call him? First man? Anyway, first gentleman, maybe. But if I were giving advice, I would say enjoy it. Take advantage of all the wonderful opportunities you do have to help others.
The role of First Lady is unique to everyone who occupies it. I don't think there's any one right or wrong way to approach it. For me, I've tried to focus on the things that I truly care about. One of the things we've tried to do, Barack and I, since we've been here, is to make this house as open as we possibly can make it to the people of this country. getting young people here for events.
There's absolutely no reason why we can't get nutritious food into every school in this country that kids will actually enjoy. You guys remind me of that every single day.
Where they get to come see the china and taste the food, because the notion is these kids don't get to see the White House in that way. It's just a big white facade, but do they ever get to walk through the doors?
I can't wait to see what you guys accomplish. You all are pretty amazing young people. So, enjoy. Wait. We have a special guest. Another person who likes this event just as much as me, who never gets invited to sit down, is the President of the United States.
Have a great kids' state dinner. All right? Even though it's technically a lunch, but calling it a state lunch, there was a debate about this, and we thought it doesn't make sense because we have state dinners. So it's a kids' state dinner, even though it's noon. All right? And parents, good job, everybody. You got great kids.
For Americans of every age, a visit to the White House is a special event. But this house is also a symbol to the rest of the world of the might and majesty of the United States. When foreign leaders come to call, they get a royal welcome. In a tradition begun by President Kennedy, a carefully orchestrated ritual is enacted on the South Lawn. It's called the State Arrival Ceremony, and it includes military honor guards, flags flying, and ruffles and flourishes. The White House may sometimes take on the trappings of a palace, but to Americans, this is a democratic palace. After all, it doesn't really belong to the president. It belongs to the people.
In the very beginning of the era of Washington and Jefferson and the early presidents, the feeling was that the White House was the people's house. In those days, from Washington's time forward, for many years, people felt, the presidents felt, that people should just be able to walk in and see their president.
And walk in they did. It's a White House tradition, making the public feel at home inside the executive mansion. In the 19th century, ordinary citizens might be invited to take tea with the president and first lady, or enjoy a picnic on the White House lawn. They can't do that anymore. But still, they keep on coming. Around 11,000 people take the official White House tour every week. Maintaining that open door policy isn't always easy.
Event that has happened out on Pennsylvania Avenue, and the Secret Service has locked down the North Lawn.
Bob, make sure the IFB is popped
up. Package or something that might have been thrown over the fence.
So no civilian is allowed out there. Only people out there are Secret Service, Park Police. They're working to clear whatever problem is. Usually it's a backpack, but you never know. You never know.
Whether it's just a backpack, accidentally left on the sidewalk by a tourist, or something truly threatening, the Secret Service won't hesitate to shut down the house. This is one of the most tightly guarded buildings in the world.
Everybody turn around, head out the gate here. You're gonna have to go out to 17th Street, please.
Defending this house while still welcoming the public is a constant challenge.
A tourist from Denver had no trouble walking into the building on Inauguration Day simply by following the Marine Corps band.
The Cessna came down 50 feet short of the White House, shattering against a 160-year-old magnolia tree, and came to rest just two floors below the presidential bedroom.
During the Clinton administration, we had a guy who actually had a firearm. He shot into the White House and hit that window up there.
No one was injured in the attack, but there was one casualty, the public's access. In 1994, President Clinton agreed to close off Pennsylvania Avenue in front of the White House to all non-pedestrian traffic.
We take this incident seriously because the White House is the people's house. And it's the job of every president who lives here to keep it safe and secure.
All presidents try to balance the security of the White House with its traditions of openness. That's especially hard during wartime, when the eyes of the nation turn to the commander-in-chief. In April 1861, Abraham Lincoln stood at the window of his second floor office and gazed across the Potomac, where Confederate flags fluttered in the breeze. He had been in the White House barely a month when the Civil War began.
You're looking out, you're seeing the Confederate camps within your eyesight, and you realize how close you are to not only losing the war that has just begun, but losing the White House. I can't imagine the anxiety he must have felt.
Less than 50 years earlier, British troops had burned the White House. Now, it was in peril once again.
The Capitol was so vulnerable, it could have been taken had the Confederates chosen to launch an assault on the Capitol, and Lincoln knew that.
Washington remained an easy target until Union troops arrived in force. Soldiers pitched camp right on the White House grounds and were even billeted inside the White House itself, in the East Room. "Thank God you have come," Lincoln told them, "for if you had not, Washington would have been in the hands of the rebels before morning." It would be 80 years before another president was forced to confront a grave threat to the White House. With the outbreak of World War II, President Roosevelt's aides quickly scrambled to protect him and his home.
As soon as Pearl Harbor happened, the Secret Service came in telling Roosevelt that he had to camouflage the White House. They had to put black curtains on the windows. No longer could people just come into the White House. No more people feeding squirrels on the White House lawn. And he accepted a few of those things. They created the sentry boxes at that time. But he refused the camouflage on the roof. He said that we have to be an emblem that we are still strong, and that this White House has to remain America's iconic structure.
The White House was never attacked during the Civil War, nor during World War II. But soldiers remain on guard here, even in times of peace. Outside the West Wing, Marines stand sentry whenever the president is in the Oval Office. And these days, there are new threats to defend against.
One of the things I always had felt about the White House was that you were always protected and that it was a fortress of sorts around the White House. And so on 9/11, you know, everything changed.
September 11th, 2001, started off as a magnificent day. That evening, the president was entertaining the entire Congress, the majority of his administration, on the South grounds.
We were having a huge party that day. It was the congressional barbecue.
So we were basically having 2,000 people coming for dinner that night. So we were in full production mode, getting things ready.
The barbecue is an annual tradition and a major event, a chance for congressional families to get together with the first family.
We were supposed to have the biggest barbecue ever in the White House that day. So on that day, I was, like many other people in the White House, busy getting ready for the barbecue.
We had 170 or 80 picnic tables on the South grounds. We had a stage set up. But that morning, Mrs. Bush was going down to Capitol Hill. So as I usually do, I escorted First Lady out to the car.
Just as I got in the car that morning to drive to the Capitol, my Secret Service agent leaned over to me and said, a plane has just flown into the World Trade Center.
And as I walked in to my office, my assistant said, look at the television. And as I looked up at the television, I saw a plane fly in to a building.
I was in the White House kitchen. Somebody came in, said that a plane hit one of the towers up in New York, and I couldn't just leave my station to go see what was going on. After a couple of minutes, I stopped cooking. I went over to the storeroom. Over in the storeroom, I knew they had a little TV. I said, maybe it's on, and let me go see what's going on.
It was like somebody hit me in the stomach. I mean, it was obvious to me at that point that this was no accident.
As we're trying to digest what just occurred, Gary Walters, the chief usher at the White House, came up behind me and said, John, this looks like a terrorist attack. There's no party tonight. Let's get everything broken down, cleaned up, put away, and let's get everybody out of here.
And so that's what we did. We started evacuating the offices in the West Wing. We had the Secret Service yelling at us to get everybody out. Just get out and run.
And as I exit the diplomatic reception room doors, I saw a huge flash of black smoke and fire. It was the fireball from the plane that flew into the Pentagon.
The head chef came running back into the kitchen and said, the Pentagon just got hit. We could be next. Evacuate.
A young lady who worked for the usher's office at the White House grabbed me, saying, Roland, get out, get out. Go as far as you can. We are on the attack. There's a plane coming for the White House in 10 minutes.
Vice President Cheney, Secretary of State Rice, and other top officials took refuge underground in a hidden bunker called the Presidential Emergency Operational Center, or PEOC. It's the safest spot in the executive mansion, built to withstand a nuclear attack.
When I got to the PEOC, the Cheneys were there and Condi was there and waited for George to come. And that's when I started to realize the duty that had fallen on George to lead our country through this dark shadow.
In spite of the risk, Chief Usher Gary Walters and a few members of his staff remained on the job, outside in the open.
We spent the next 7 hours on the South grounds, moving picnic tables, moving things out of the way. One of the things that I turned to in my own mind on 9/11 was the role that the White House plays in disasters, wars. People have a tendency to turn to the White House. And I knew that the president wasn't going to be satisfied talking from a bunker somewhere or away from the White House. And that's why we put the effort that we did into cleaning up the South grounds so that that helicopter could land there. That was what the American people were used to seeing, presidential helicopter coming in, and the president was going to address the nation from the Oval Office.
At 7 o'clock that evening, after crisscrossing the country on Air Force One, the president returned to the White House to deal with the crisis and reassure the public.
None of us will ever forget this day, yet we go forward to defend freedom and all that is good and just in our world.
There's nothing any more powerful than the president addressing the nation from the Oval Office. And in times of crisis, I think that's something that people can fall back on. There is some kind of normalcy from the White House, from the president. The White House is a symbol. I mean, I don't know how else to put it. It is a symbol of our American heritage.
Protect our children!
Protect our children! In spite of concerns about security, there's another American tradition that can't be denied. Not even here in front of the White House. Citizens are free to make their voices heard within earshot of the Oval Office.
To demand that our president.
We saw protest all the time. And it's not just anti-war protest, but it's many different kinds of protest of people calling on the president to do something.
And if you come to Washington, you can get as close to our executive mansion and as just about any other country in the world. It is an accessible place, some would argue too accessible.
The White House has always been a magnet for protesters. But no one was ready for the scale of the demonstrations protesting the Vietnam War.
We know that most people's intentions are good. We don't question their motives. We've never said they're unpatriotic, although they say some pretty ugly things about us. We believe very strongly in preserving the right to differ in this country and the right to dissent. And if I have done a good job of anything since I've been president, is to ensure that there are plenty of dissenters.
Even behind the walls of the White House, the president could not ignore the outcry against a war many believed was unjust.
They would exercise their rights to protest, and they did stand right outside our window across in Lafayette Square and say some things that were very hurtful.
As the war dragged on, so did the protests. Late at night, President Johnson would retreat to the Situation Room, a secure command center in the basement of the West Wing. There, he would wait for the teletype machines to print reports from the battlefield half a world away, including the latest body counts.
He had two sons-in-law who were in Vietnam during the height of his presidency when he was waging a war in that country. It was very, very personal for LBJ.
As a White House correspondent, and not I alone, frequently think what it must have been like to pull back the curtains, look out, see on the street, hear people shouting, see the signs.
And as he sees protesters across the street and he's looking out at these signs, hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?
You think about his daughters having their husbands fight in Vietnam and hearing just across the White House gates.
And it was constant, the constant drumbeat. It wasn't just one day, almost every night.
The war continued long after LBJ left office, and the protests grew more militant during the administration of his successor. To protect the Nixon White House, the military literally circled the wagons, surrounding the building with city buses.
Nixon was almost literally a prisoner of the White House in those days. The notion of being a prisoner of the White House is very common for all the modern presidents. They feel that they're really trapped in this White House. And the reason is, just think about how the president lives.
President Truman famously called it the Great White Jail. In a letter to his daughter, he lamented, "This old place cracks and pops all night long. And you can well imagine that old Jackson or Andy Johnson or some other ghost is walking. Why they'd want to come back here, I could never understand. It's a nice prison, but a prison nevertheless."
There's no way the security apparatus is going to let a president and his or her family have a normal life. They're not living normal lives, and I think they realize it.
presidents fight so hard to get in the White House, and then once they're there, they're desperate to get out of the place. It's a colossal irony, and President Obama thinks of it as the bubble, where he can't escape from the normal tedium, really, of the White House unless he really tries.
Being in the bubble is tough. I think Bill Clinton called it the crown jewel of the federal penal system. And there is a sense, because of the security demands today, that you are trapped. You know, Teddy Roosevelt used to go up with a single Secret Service agent and go camping in Yellowstone for a month. Wouldn't tell anybody where he's going. FDR might go sailing up the coast to Nova Scotia in the middle of World War II, and Harry Truman used to take daily walks outside.
On one bright spring day, the 44th president broke out of his bubble to take an unscheduled walk from the White House to the Treasury building next door, enjoying a rare moment of spontaneity.
My name is Han.
Good to see you. That's my mother's name.
You're having a good visit? Thank you. How are you?
Sorry to mess up your run.
It's okay.
Good to see you. You guys were right in the middle of it. What's your names?
Cora. Cora.
You're Cora? How old are you, Cora?
Yeah.
It's good to be out. The bear is loose. You won't. Give me a hug.
Oh! Oh! Can we get a picture?
Yes, come on.
Oh, Pat, do you want one too?
Come on, Pat. I'll get it. He'll take it. Are you trying to go home? And here I am messing you up.
Presidents find all sorts of ways to mingle with the public. And from time to time, they invite the public to join them, right on the White House grounds.
When this music comes on, I need y'all to go nuts, right? Cue the music.
One of the oldest White House traditions is the Easter egg roll, dating back to 1878. It's also the biggest annual event on the South Lawn. This year, 35,000 Americans, many of them under the age of 12, will join the celebration. Each administration likes to give the tradition its own unique spin. This First Lady is using the event to publicize her Let's Move campaign, promoting health and fitness for kids.
First and foremost, it was always, let's open up the house. Let's think of new ways to turn, you know, events that have been around for a while into something even better that involves more people, especially kids. She loves to bring kids into the house.
Like everything about the White House, this custom continues to evolve, but its purpose remains the same: to give young Americans an unforgettable experience at the home of their president. In charge of the details is White House Social Secretary Jeremy Bernard.
The Marine Band will be on either side of the balcony, and then the President, First Lady will come out, walk out onto the balcony and speak from up here. Hello, how are you?
Good morning. How
Welcome
are you
back.
Doing? Yeah, well, thank
good
you very much.
Good to see you.
It's good to be back.
Good to be back. So you were here in 2009?
Yeah, I was the first bunny, yes.
You were the first, wow.
Yes, and what an experience.
It's a little spooky, I think, for the kids to see the Easter Bunny with its head off.
But yeah.
We'll fix that.
That won't happen outside.
Yeah, right,
yes.
Exactly. Thank you.
You bet. Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody. Happy Easter. We are so blessed to have this beautiful day and to have so many friends in our backyard.
Happy
when you work here day to day, it would be easy to lose touch of how special it is. Except when you see people come in, whether it's for a tour or a dinner or an Easter egg roll, how excited people are to be here.
For a casual visitor or a two-term president, there is just something about the White House that always inspires awe.
This is a living, breathing house that is changing every year, every minute.
In this fragmented, internet-driven, snarky age, we still have need of collectively experiencing history as it is being made.
When you go to Washington, you see dozens of people on the street with their backs against the fence and the White House as the backdrop, and somebody's taking a picture of them and they're waving as if it's their backyard. People still feel like this is the place we want to go to be connected to one another, connected to this moment in history, connected to our president, and connected to our country.
When the crowds leave, this is still a place where the nation's critical business is conducted, the base of operations for the leader of the most powerful country on earth. From the first day of an administration to its final moments, the White House bestows upon every president its unique aura of grandeur and authority.
The White House is the center of power in the United States. It's the symbol of our democracy. It's a symbol of who we are as a people.
It goes beyond patriotism. It's bigger than party, it's bigger than president.
The White House may be a hallowed place whose walls ring with the echoes of American history. But at the same time, it is now, as it has always been, a home on loan from the nation to its leader. A leader who serves at the will of the people.
In our United States of America, the occupant of the White House, the president, is not seen as a descendant of a sun god or some deity. He's another citizen who's been given the highest honor we can give him, to lead our country, but he's a person.
Well, we were prepared to say goodbye. And the awful part was saying goodbye to the staff. And I remember George Haney, who later became the head butler, he said, "Mrs. Bush, presidents come and go. George Haney stays." And he did.
I think what I actually will miss most, it has more to do with the people. From the landscapers who maintain the Rose Garden to 20-something-year-olds who prepared my packet of letters to my chief of staff and my cabinet. They understand the incredible privilege we all have in working here. And there's a sense of seriousness and responsibility and commitment that the place confers on you. And that never leaves you.
I would hope that every first family that has the honor of living here is thinking in terms of this house being a house that evolves and grows with us as a nation. In this house that is the people's house.
The White House Inside Story is available on DVD. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS.